blood is a wide open balloon in space, so the coloration on the surface doesn't create any problem. You have a very nice thin scar on the surface like you see after any types of fulguration.
There were a few questions about whether for some people they would need to repeat the procedure. You just mentioned that that's likely, especially in that case. How far apart would these procedures usually be, or how long do you have to wait?
Yes, so we've published on that, so you know we have some data that we can provide mm-hmm. to your leadership. But I typically wait 6 months after the fulguration to make that decision on repeat treatments, just because I know it takes that time to heal in the mm-hmm. bladder. The bladder is a very obviously wet environment. The healing takes forever. The scab takes some time. People will notice, you know, some pieces of tissue coming out. Mm-hmm. The urine sometimes with the blood as well for a long time. And so after the scab comes off, new tissue has to regrow. And I've used 6 months as a fairly safe timeline to reevaluate everybody. Okay. And at 6 months, we either have what we call endoscopic success or endoscopic failures. The success is a good prognosticator for me that they're going to probably do quite well, but they could still get reinfected later on. We've had a few people like that where they were fine, and then you go back and look 5, 6, 10 years later, and then your lesion has formed. So that's fine. I mean, if you have a chronic condition like diabetes, where you're more exposed to having infection, or you've had chemotherapy, whatever happened in your life, you could have another infection in your lifetime because you still have plenty of bladder tissue in which bacteria can attach. Mm-hmm. If, on the other hand, you have some lesions seen at the time of that cystoscopy in the bladder, not really will necessarily progress. We've had people with some lesion that we saw, but there were not that many, and we just do nothing about it because the volume of infection sites, in my opinion, is not enough to really, you know, mm-hmm. provoke a lot of infection. But I've been proven wrong on that. Some people have progressed no matter what.
Okay.
And so those are the people who will consider to repeat fulguration, but typically there is probably another 3 to 6 months between that 6 month check and when we go back, just to see what the evolution is. Mm-hmm. And you see very quickly if people keep recurring like they did before, and especially if it's the same bacteria again, then they will go back and try to help them out the second time or third time. We've kept at it, you know, as many times as we need, you know.
Okay.
You know, most of these patients by then cannot rely on antibiotics. They don't have too many antibiotic choices. Mm-hmm. So we know it's not something that the antibiotics will fix. That has been proven by their current history up to
right now.
So, you know, what do we have left? It's either I keep fighting at it with the colorization, which is the only tool I have right now until better options come along. Mm-hmm. Or in some desperate cases, we end up having people requiring the bladder to be removed, which is obviously a major decision that happens a few times a year. Because we have nothing left and people are left with only one or two, you know, sometimes just one or two IV antibiotics left for treatment. So they've been septic, hospitalized, you know, their life is on the line. That's a different story.
Yeah.
Partially extremely rare. I don't want your readership to think that happens every 5 minutes, but you know.
Mm-hmm. Right. A couple of people asked about infection in the bladder, neck and the urethra and whether that can be fulgurated.
You have to be very careful when you do that because you can create scar and that can lead to strictures. So the answer in general would say no. Mm-hmm. Some people have fairly large, we call polyps, inflammatory polyps at the bladder neck. Cautious, you know, very cautious there when you cauterize. You only have to be very selective. If you end up cauterizing the whole area, you will get bladder neck scarring and that can mm-hmm. be dangerous, obviously.
Why isn't scarring an issue in other areas in the bladder?
Well, because you're flowing through that area. So if it scars down and tightens in the area, you can have trouble to empty your bladder.
And does this not happen in other areas in the bladder away from there?
The bladder is a wide open balloon in space. So the cauterization on the surface doesn't create any problem.
Okay.
The tissue heals. You have a very nice thin scar on the surface like you see after any types of fulguration. And that doesn't cause any problem whatsoever because it's just a superficial process. It doesn't affect the deeper layers of the bladder.
Mm-hmm. So for people that do have infection in the bladder, neck and the urethra, what would be the approach that you would take there if fulguration is not possible?
It's very infrequent, Melissa, that we see that, to be honest with you. I've seen a few cases of what we call urethritis, mm-hmm. and that's where you respond pretty well to antibiotics. At the bladder neck, it's, you know, as I say, you see sometimes bladder neck polyps, and you can leave them alone or just cauterize them, but again, be very careful there.
How deeply does fulguration penetrate the lining of the bladder?
Not much. It's just on the surface. We have, in fact, some upcoming data on a few biopsies of those areas after they heal. So mm-hmm. I can reassure you it's very, very superficial.
Okay. And you mentioned that it's done under anesthesia. Does it hurt when you wake up?
No, it doesn't hurt when you wake up. We've done a few in the office when there are a few spots recently under local. So I think if you had only a few lesions, you could try it in the office setting under local, but not everybody's going to tolerate that. So I would say it's so easy nowadays, so very light anesthesia and not feel anything. And when you wake up, no, you don't feel anything. Some people will feel, you know, like for a burn, they will feel like it's, they have maybe more frequency and urgency maybe for mm-hmm. a few days. But I think the number of people that have it done that say they really didn't feel much is still the majority.
Okay.
We're looking at that, by the way, so we'll have some data for you in the coming months.
Oh, that'll be good.
We've been looking back at our first 6 months data to look at, you know, how many people have symptoms, need treatment, mm-hmm. whatever afterwards. So,
okay.
Because as clinician, you always remember a couple of people recently, you don't necessarily remember the whole
group. Of course.
Group. So,
that would be difficult.
I tasked one of my students to go back to all my charts and electronic records and just tally what happened to my patients based on my chart messages and phone calls and mm-hmm. prescription, okay. et cetera. So, I'll be able to have a more scientific answer to your question. But I would say I ask people to always take some time off. I don't want them to have to drive if they feel like they have to stop mm-hmm. in the bathroom every 20 minutes. But, you know, many of them come back and say, you know, you forewarned me it's going to be terrible, but it was really not bad at all. I guess when you've been through bad bladder infections, it's probably, you know, you're ready for so much worse than what it is. So if you never had anything, it might be, you might feel it differently. Mm-hmm. But when you're accustomed to having had problems in that area and a lot of pain and discomfort, you know, it's very little compared to that prior experience. If that's what I'm saying makes sense.
Yeah, that makes sense, definitely. During the procedure, are nerves damaged, and could this somehow provide more pain relief right afterwards?
Well, you know, there are nerves everywhere in the bladder, even, you know, very superficially. So obviously those nerves are going to be, you know, the end part of those nerves are going to be gone. I don't know if there is regeneration in the long term. That's a good question. Mm-hmm. I have not heard anybody complaining of, you know, nerve pain or anything afterwards. If anything, it may decrease the sensitivity and make you more able to tolerate things in the future. Mm-hmm. You don't have this, you know, super sensation from all this inflammation being there anymore.
Yeah, I think that's what the question was around, whether it could be beneficial in that way to have less sensitivity.
Yes, people have really claimed that in some report that there is, you know, less urgency, less frequency afterwards. Mm-hmm. It would be a way to treat people with this problem. So, it's fairly understudied because we don't have really great tools to assess that. We don't have any great sensitivity test assays right now.
Mm-hmm. Okay.
So keep that in mind for a future question in a few years when we revisit together.
We'll keep an eye out, that's for sure. Could fulguration be of benefit for those diagnosed with chronic UTI, even if their bladder looks fine because they've been on long-term antibiotic treatment?
I have not been in that situation. I've seen the opposite. People on long-term antibiotics have this chronic infection, and that's why every time they stop, it comes back. Mm-hmm. I don't remember seeing too many people with completely normal bladders. I've seen. And if they have normal bladders, then, you know, I don't know why I would fulgurate them.
Yeah.
Nothing that I can see that seems wrong. You know, I would leave them alone. Mm-hmm. So either on the day I scoped them, they were better because, you know, the bladder will change, obviously, from day to day. I do see people that are placed on antibiotics chronically for like 3 months or 6 months, when you do sequential cystoscopy in the office, you can notice an improvement. Mm-hmm. Less redness, less debris floating in the bladder. It's not as cloudy. They feel better. So, you can see that the antibiotics do work for some mm-hmm. people more than others. And some you take the pictures 3 months before or 6 months before now, and it's, you wouldn't know which one is which because they look exactly the same. They
yeah.
Absolutely nothing. So,
Are there any cases where the bladder is so damaged that you wouldn't recommend fulguration?
I've never given up on that because I know that the only alternative would be to remove the bladder mm-hmm. if I did that. So, and I think most patients that have been through that say, they were glad they tried, a simple approach like fulguration mm-hmm. before committing to lifelong without the bladder. So, no, I've never had this sentiment that you can, tackle it, but it's a much more complicated procedure. It takes much longer time. So, mm-hmm. schedule it. It's not going to be 10, 15, 20 minutes. They have to schedule an hour and a half, possibly up to 2 hours.
Okay.
A much longer recovery, potentially more discomfort afterwards.
Mm-hmm.
So,
okay.
This becomes one of the exceptional, situations here, not the most common situation that we encounter.
Someone also asked a question about whether fulguration could help with non-bacterial infections, so potentially caused by virus or parasites.
I wish I can answer that, but we are far away from that. We will have an upcoming publication with Dr. Denisco that will describe a little bit of the virome and what we find in mm-hmm. these bladders. But whether the fulguration helps, that's a totally different question.
Mm-hmm. Okay.
Now that's a big area of unknown right now.
And we do have one other question. It's around fecal and urinary incontinence and how someone could keep the area clean in order to help prevent infection.
Yeah, every time there are bowel issues, fecal incontinence, diarrhea, you really have to do best to try to handle that. I defer to our colorectal team in those domains because that's not something I practice, mm-hmm. On a daily basis, but it's true that the increase of bacteria in the area can lead to infection. Now, I don't know if you had kids and changed the diapers, but you could think that every kid should have a raging infection mm. given the mixture of urine and poop that you have there, and they don't. So obviously, our bodies can handle lots of bacterial load without having problems with it, and that goes back to the discussion we had on the microbiome and your own natural defense mechanism. So I think there's more to it than,
mm-hmm.
I don't want to oversimplify that. We have women who have fecal incontinence who don't have bladder infection. We mm-hmm. have, women who have both, and that's a problem. And obviously we try to eliminate that problem by asking them to visit with the proper expert on that.
Mm-hmm. that field.